Hello, in this part I would like to demonstrate to you the situation where that the task is finishing its job earlier than specified time slice. So we will use again STM32 cube IDE and we'll run our example on Nucleo L476RG board, but you can reproduce it quite easily on any other STM32 based board. So just not to, let's say, start everything from the beginning, I would use one of the existing projects which we have used before for tasks, and I would start with a device configuration. So just for those of you who are starting with us right now, please start a new project with an STM32 Cube MX or STM32 Cube IDE. For a selected STM32 device, please select within System and Core and Sys Debug to trace asynchronous SW. It will be not available when Cortex-M0 and M0 Plus devices, but in this case we can just use the standard debug interface and use UART communication as a support for debug. Within Cortex-M3, M4 and M7 devices, once we select this trace asynchronous SW, we've got one additional pin. It is PB3, it is SWO, single wire output pin, which can be used for single wire tracing. Additional point, common for all STM32 implementations when using FreeRTOS, is a time-based source change. Time-based source within this sys tab means that this is the timer which is used to implement all delays and timeouts within HAL library. So by default it is systick, but as we are using FreeRTOS, which is using systick for the time slicing, we need to change this time-base for HAL to different timer. We can select from all of the existing ones, but the best is to select the timer which do not have any input nor output channels. So it could be timer 6 or timer 7. I select the timer 6. I will not use at the moment any other components, any other peripherals nor pins. So I would just enable middlewares, within middlewares, the FreeRTOS. So I select FreeRTOS. My interface is CMC's version 2. We've got as well version 1 and disable. So we are selecting version 2. And we do not need to modify anything within this config nor include parameters. So we can keep the default settings. Let's go to the task and queues. As I'm using one of the previous exercises, I've got already two tasks specified. You can add new ones using this add button and modify existing by double click on the name. Within this exercise we will have two tasks on the same priority, OS priority normal. So I will double click and change this priority to normal without this two. So two tasks have the same priority. The entry functions will have task 1, start task 1, and for task 2 will have start task 2. There would be no other component within this perspective, so I will generate the code using this button. Okay, and within our code we can see main.c file. Within the private variables, the definition of both tasks and its handlers. Then within main function, after the hardware initialization, we can see the declaration and creation of those two tasks. Then the kernel is started and we are executing the code from both tasks. So within this exercise, I would like to demonstrate to you how task can finish its job a bit earlier. So I would keep only this task action code and I would remove all of the other components which are not necessary here. There would be no initialization values, only the task actions. So let's assume that we've got the situation where our task 1 will have only a small portion of data to be done, and it's the time slice defined for it is much too much. So we need to finish earlier and give the time space to the other tasks. How to do it? We've got a dedicated function, which is os thread yield. This mechanism is called yielding, and this function is calling, in fact, a similar function within FreeRTOS API, which is sending our task from run state to ready state. And this is forcing scheduler to switch the context using pendSV interrupt to next task, the same priority, from the ready list. If there would be no other, let's say, task from the ready list, the scheduler will select again the same task, task one. So please be careful when using this function with the task which has higher priority than the others, because scheduler will select automatically the same task once again. But in our case, both tasks have the same priority, it is OS priority normal, so this function should work without any problem. This function do not accept any argument, so this is just, this is in fact calling pendSV interrupt to switch the context for the next task, which is in the queue. So this is our task 1 function, and for task 2, we will perform only this operation without any yielding. So task 2 will use its complete time space for the execution. Let's try to compile it and check the final result. It will be quite difficult to check the difference, in fact, because we are operating on 4 MHz clock, on the default one. It will be quite fast, but we will see. A compilation demonstrates no warnings, so we can start with the debug session. My board is already connected, so I press this debug button. Then I need to turn on this SWD ITM data console, just to show you once again how to find it. I'm using this quick access SWV, and this SWD ITM data console, this is the one I'm using. Once you select it, you need to configure it, selecting channel 0 as ITM port. ITM means instrumentation trace macro cell, so this is the trace. We are using only one wire over SWO line. This is PB3 pin. Then to start the tracing, we need to start it by pressing this button, and we can run the application. So we can see, I would pause it for a while, and let's have a look how it is working. I would scroll for the beginning. So at the beginning, we can see that task 2 is executing many times. And then from time to time, we can see task 1. The explanation for this is the following. Let me come back to main.c file. And within our code, we have specified the time slice for each task for 1 millisecond. And within this 1 millisecond, the task is executing the code from this endless loop. So in case of task 2, it will be sending these 2 over ITM interface one by one, as fast as possible within this 1 millisecond. This is why we can see a lot of, let's say, sign of life from task 2. And as task 1 is sending only once its data, and then it is going immediately to ready state, we can see from time to time only the sign of life from task 1. So the effect is visible, but please remember that yield function should be used among the tasks with the same priority. If you would like to block somehow or to finish earlier of, let's say, the job of the task with higher priority, better use OS delay instead, which would put your higher priority task to the blocked state. Okay, we can terminate or stop the debug session and continue with the next topic. Thank you for watching this video.